church. Glad to be with you this Sunday, the 20th day of September. What the church calendar tells us is the 16th Sunday after Pentecost. We're good to gather with you this morning as we worship our risen Lord and Savior together. As far as announcements are concerned, there was a big turnout Friday night at the Jordan Lee benefit dinner. Thanks to everybody who provided desserts for the bake sale, who maybe bought a plate, who bought a t-shirt, what have you, who participated on the online Facebook auction. I know the auction itself raised about $10,000. They sold 800 plates at $10 a plate. You can figure that out. I can't. I don't know how many t-shirts that they sold, or so they did well. And it was neat to see the community gathered to try to support that young lady and her family. I know traffic was backed up from my house all the way down to the high school on 43, so it was something neat to see. So thank you for everybody that participated. We'll continue our Bible study this week, Book of Romans. We're in week number 8, 7 o'clock each night on the church's Facebook page. If you missed the first 7 weeks, don't worry about it. You can start with us tomorrow night afresh, or if you want to go back and see what you missed, all the lessons are saved on the church's Facebook page, as well as on a YouTube channel that I have for that particular purpose. Our charge conference is headed this way. It is a week from Tuesday night, September 29th, 7 p.m. Via Zoom. So if you are, if you have internet access, if you have a laptop or a tablet, and if you have an email address, then you'll be able to participate in the charge conference. And I'll send the links out to everybody that I have email addresses for. If I don't have an email address and you want to participate, you need to let me know this week so I can make sure you get the email so you can participate in that. And don't forget that in October, this is looking ahead, that on Halloween Day or Halloween evening from 4 to 6, we're having a trunk or treat here at the church. So if you'll want to participate, all you need really is a car and some candy, and you'll be able to participate. Either park here or park over here, open up the trunk, give out candy. You can decorate if you want to. You can wear a costume if you want to. Come out and participate. And as far as I can tell, so far we're the first ones to announce anything in regards to Halloween. Let's see how you do. Everybody's watching now. Pressure's on you. Just gonna see how you do. Yes, sir. Very good. Very good. If you notice, he folded it into an airplane. I think that's trial and error. That's a scientific method, right? You're trying to figure out the best way to get something. And
air.
That's right.
Dynamics.
That's right. Is that what he does? Yeah. And the last announcement is that you may have noticed I've added a little bit to my outfit up here. That's because this past Thursday at a clergy session at North Carolina Annual Conference, I was voted in to the Order of Elders. So I'm now an elder in full connection with the United Methodist of the Church. It's been kind of neat, I think, that you guys have seen me grow up, so to speak. When I first got here, I was licensed local pastor. Then a year later, I was commissioned as a provisional elder, and now I'm ordained as an elder in full connection. So thanks to everybody who has supported me and prayed for me during the time I've been here as your pastor. With that being said, who else has an announcement or something they want? Yes, Sherry.
First of all, tell Ben and tell his dad don't leave here without talking to me.
Okay, very good. Ben, you got that?
Don't sneak away. Right. My father is going back in the hospital again. He's getting a pacemaker this week. Okay. So probably Thursday. They're thinking Tuesday, but I'm saying no.
Which, is he Norfolk or?
No, here in Elizabeth City, yes. Yeah, he's, yes. So just be overnight. He's kind of looking forward to it. He's 91. I'm like, okay.
Right.
But keep him in your thoughts and prayers. Other than that, he's doing okay.
Good. Who else this morning has something on? Yes, Juanita.
We need to keep the family of Ralph Sawyer in our prayers. He passed away last evening.
Ralph did.
Yeah.
And also to give you an update on our daughter. Mm-hmm. She has a cranial staph infection. Mm-hmm. And so she's has a thick one, and she's taking antibiotics twice a day for 38 weeks.
Oh, wow. Ooh. Is she still at Duke, or is she home now?
She came home Monday night.
Okay, very good. Wow. Continue to pray
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Walt. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, sir. Who else this morning? Let us go to the Lord in prayer again. Sovereign Lord, who is there like you in heaven or on the earth? There is no one that even comes close. You alone are worthy of our praise. And so we have come to worship you, to praise your name, to proclaim your power and glory, to retell the stories of your goodness, to sing of your righteousness, to remember your mercy and compassionate love, to once again affirm that you are our God and that we are your people. Through the power of your Holy Spirit and the intercession of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to your presence among us. Open our hearts and minds to hear your voice, to recognize your call, and to faithfully follow where you lead. To you alone, Sovereign Lord, belongs all glory and honor and praise, now and to the end of time. Amen. Friends, I want to invite you now to join me as we say together our call to worship. Come, let's praise God together. For God is great and worthy of our praise. Let's tell stories of God's power and majesty, his mighty acts throughout history. For God is great and worthy of our praise. Let's remember the compassion he has shown toward us, His mercy and unfailing love generation after generation. For God is great and worthy of our praise. Let's pass these stories along to our children and grandchildren so that they too may come to know and love our God. For God is great and worthy of our praise. Let's worship God together. Amen. As we come now to our first reading of Scripture for this morning, and we await with joyous anticipation what the Lord would have be revealed to us through His written word, I want to invite you to join me as we say together our prayer for illumination. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the Scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Our first reading this morning comes from the Gospel according to John. It's the 6th chapter, verses 27 through 34. Again, this is John chapter 6, verses 27 through 34. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal. And they said to him, what must we do to perform the works of God? Jesus answered them, this is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent. So they said to him, what sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. Then Jesus said to them, very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. They said to him, sir, give us this bread always. Friends, this is the word of God for you and I, the children of God.
Thanks be to God.
As we come now to our time of confession before God and each other, we'll pray together, but the first part of the prayer will be a silent prayer. And during this time of silence, I urge you to take a look back at the week that was. I think about those things that maybe you said, you shouldn't have said, those things that you did, you shouldn't have done, those things you thought that you shouldn't have thought in the first place. Trusting that God is merciful and good and willing to forgive us of our transgressions. So I invite you now to join me as we go to the Lord in prayer. Holy and merciful God, we confess to you our forgetfulness. We confront today our waywardness. We accept, Lord, that we are sinful. To turn to our past is to recall both your great acts of love and kindness as well as many moments and situations where we know we failed you. And yet, your love remains. And so in humility and brokenness we pray. We ask you to forgive. We ask, Lord, that you would heal. Buy us back, Lord. Redeem us from our slavery to ourselves and our own way. Crown us again with your acceptance and care. Satisfy the real thirst of our soul. Renew us with the strength that only you can give. Reveal yourself to us again as a God of grace, rich in mercy, patient with our wandering. As far as the rising sun is from the setting sun, remove our sin from us. Today, Lord, and together, Lord, we declare our affection, our adoration, and our praise for you. In the holy and loving name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Sisters and brothers, brothers hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, proving God's love for us. In the name of Christ Jesus, you are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. What about you now to join me as we make our statement of faith, our confession of faith, as we with one voice recite those words as contained in our Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our second reading for this morning comes from the Old Testament book of Exodus. We're in chapter 16, verses 2 through 15. Again, this is Exodus chapter 16, verses 2 through 15. The whole congregation of the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread. For you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I'm going to rain bread from heaven for you. And each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. In that way I will test them, whether they will follow my instruction or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather on other days." So Moses and Aaron said to all the Israelites, "In the evening you shall know that it was the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt. And in the morning you shall see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your complaining against the Lord. For what are we that you complain against us?" And Moses said, "When the Lord gives you meat to eat in the evening and your fill of bread in the morning, because the Lord has heard the complaining that you utter against him, what are we? Your complaining is not against us, but against the Lord." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of the Israelites, draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaining." And as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the Israelites, they looked toward the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. The Lord spoke to Moses and said, "I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, at twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God." In the evening, quails came up and covered the camp. In the morning, there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine, flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, "What is it?" For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, "It is the bread that the Lord has given you." Friends, this is the word of God for you and I, the children of God.
Thanks be to God.
See if this scenario or this story sounds familiar. Maybe it's played out at your house. About 4 o'clock, 4:30 in the afternoon. And you're right in the middle of something. Whether it be work or housework or you're reading, you're doing something. You start to hear this grumbling coming from the younger members of the household. "I'm hungry. When are we eating? What's for supper?" 10-15 minutes goes by. Then you hear it again. "I'm hungry. When are we eating? What's for supper?" So what do? You stop doing whatever it is that you were doing. see what you have on hand. This scenario played out at our house a few months ago. What we had on hand was a head of cabbage and some hamburger meat. So Heidi went online and she found this recipe for something called egg roll in a bowl. You brown the meat, you saute the cabbage, a few spices here, a little sauce there, and you have a fairly easy tasting meal. So we took it up and we put it in bowls and we put it on the table and we called the kids for supper. And we sit down and we have this meal in front of us. What do the kids say? What is it? What is it? Yes, we've been grumbling and complaining about our hunger. We didn't have any role in this meal that's been placed before us, but before we touch it, we need to know what it is. And oftentimes that question of what is it is followed by the statement, I don't like it, before they even put it in their mouth. Or yuck, as you're saying. That sounds familiar to anyone? Well, you know who it would definitely sound familiar to? Moses. When we last left our Israelite friends last week, they had just passed through the Red Sea thanks to God fighting for them. The Egyptian army had been defeated, and now off they go toward the Promised Land, free of any fear of Pharaoh or his troops. Once they get to the other side of the Red Sea, Scripture tells us they sing a song to the Lord. We read that Aaron's sister Miriam even grabs a tambourine, and she sings a solo for them, saying, "Sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. Horse and rider he has thrown into the sea." Good times, right? And then what? Well, after traveling for 3 days without finding water, the third day they come to a place with water. But the water didn't taste good, and so the people complained to Moses about it. So Moses takes their complaints to the Lord. The Lord says, "Here, take this piece of wood, throw it into the water, and it'll make the water taste sweet." Moses did as he was asked, and the water was good. And they continue on, but things get even worse. We're about a month and a half since they left Egypt at this point. And this time the crisis was a lack of food. And this lack of food is what brought on another round of complaints. They are traveling through a pretty desolate area, so this area could not support such a large group. And they were on foot, so every day they're working up a pretty healthy appetite. And they come to Moses and Aaron and say, "If only we had died by the hands of the Lord in Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread, that'd been a whole lot better than you guys dragging us out here to die of starvation in the wilderness." In other words, they're saying what? "I'm hungry. What's the supper? When are we eating?" And so God announces his plan to Moses and Aaron. He says, "I'm going to rain bread from heaven down on them. And each day, the people should go out and gather just enough for that day. And that way I'll test them to see if they follow my instructions or not." And so Moses goes to the people and says, "In the morning you will see the glory of the Lord." Now, I don't know about you, but every time I read about bread from heaven, I think about my great-grandmother Booth. She used to make the absolute best bread that I have ever had in my life. Real sweet, kind of melts in your mouth, real yeasty and full of gluten. And that's what I think of anytime I think of bread being heaven sent. But when these folks wake up, what they see is this fine, flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. They look around at each other and look at Moses and they say, "Manna." Now, we hear that word manna, and we'll automatically think, bread from heaven, because that's what we've been told. But actually, in Hebrew, you know what manna means? What is it? What is it? These Israelites who have been moaning and complaining about being hungry, then being told God will provide what they needed, when they awake and find food, through no effort at all of their own, mind you, they say to Moses, "What is it?" Guarantee at least one of them said, "I don't like it." But friends, this story is about a physical hunger. The literal absence of food to nourish bodies and the Lord then providing what is needed to feed and strengthen and assist and encourage his people on their journey toward the Promised Land. But friends, we are also on a journey toward the Promised Land. A journey that will lead all of us one day to paradise, to the presence of our Heavenly Father, to each one of us sitting down to the heavenly feast. No matter when you began your journey, the day you said yes to Jesus, yes to making Jesus the Lord of your life, and yes to living the kind of life God wants you to live, then yes, you began a journey towards the promised land yourself. A journey that in the meantime calls us to be the love and the light to our families and to our community. And just like the Israelites, we need to be fed, strengthened, assisted, and encouraged on this journey. When we feel weak, or take a misstep, or want to stop, or start to complain that things were better before we began this journey, and we want to go back to what we knew back then, to what was easy and comfortable and felt good, all that means, friends, is that we are hungry. Not physically hungry for bread, but spiritually hungry for the bread of life. Now, we all know what I mean by bread of life, right? John 6:35 is right after what we read earlier this morning. Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." I think most anyone who has ever had even a fleeting exposure to the church knows that Jesus is the bread of life. So I won't expand upon that too much. Except to say that this is the exact same bread that we will refer to in a little bit when we say the Lord's Prayer. And we ask, "Give us this day our daily bread." It is this bread that we need to prevent ourselves from becoming spiritually hungry, from becoming spiritually weak, unable to continue the journey and prone to go back to Egypt, back to our old sinful selves. And friends, you must make sure that you are taking in the bread of life. You say, "Well, don't worry about me, Pastor Mark. I come to or watch worship every Sunday, and I pray the prayers that you pray, and I listen to the songs, and I follow the scriptures being read, and I hear and take in the word you preach every Sunday. I get what I need here. It keeps my spiritual tank full until the next Sunday. So don't worry about me." Well, first, I am going to worry about you. Not because I'm necessarily concerned about you, but because I love every one of you. And I want nothing more than to ensure that we all get to sit together one day in paradise. But second, listen to this. Growing up, and I've told this story a number of times, but growing up, every Sunday afternoon, was spent with my aunts and uncles and cousins at Grandma Audrey's house. And we'd eat. We'd have fried chicken and potato salad and green beans and corn and rolls and any number of desserts. And we'd eat and eat and eat. We couldn't wait till the next Sunday because we knew we were going to do the exact same thing all over again. But what if I didn't eat or drink a single thing that week until we got together again at Grandma Audrey? Would I get hungry? Yes. Is that healthy? No. Could there be long-term effects to that? Yup. How many in here would be willing to go 6 days without eating or drinking? Anybody? No. Then why are we so willing to go 6 days without the bread of life? Give us this day our daily bread. Not give me the bread I need for the next few days. Not give me the bread I need for the next few weeks. No, give me this day, right here, right now, Jesus, this day. Give me this day what I need for today. Prayer, scripture reading, small group, Bible study, daily devotion. This day, Lord, every day, speak into my life and give me what I need to be strengthened and encouraged and supported on my walk with you. Now compare that with what I just said, with what the Lord told the Israelites about the manna in our lesson this morning. Because he told them what? Go out and gather what you need for that day. Just that day. Which means what? He expected them to go out every day for what the Lord provided for them. If they tried to hoard more than that, it spoiled and became inedible. So if you think you can get all you need for the week just on Sundays, guess what? You can't. Each day, the Lord expected the Israelites to partake in the bread that he provided for them. Each and every day. Except for one day. There was one day they didn't have to do any gathering. Guess what day that was? Saturday. This day is your Saturday. And so the Lord has provided for you and to me a space where we can receive the bread of life today, the presence of Jesus Christ himself, celebrated through song and prayer and proclamation of the word. A space where you can bring your praises of thanksgiving to him and your laments and confession and prayers of supplication. And I pray that each Sunday that you feel that you are being fed enough through our worship time together. But sisters and brothers, this cannot be all that you do. This cannot be it. The Lord expects you, all of you, expects me, tomorrow, Tuesday, and Wednesday, and Thursday, and Friday, and Saturday, to be feasting on the bread of life. The Lord expects that when you ask, give me this day my daily bread, that we realize it does not take some superhuman effort to find it. All we need has been provided for us, just as the Lord provided manna and quail for the Israelites. We all have Bibles. Read them. We all have smartphones. There's any number of ways to access scripture and devotions. You can even set reminders at any time of day you need to tell you, hey, get into the Word right now. Use them. Just about everybody has an email address. You can have devotions sent to your email each and every day. Find them. Pray. Don't be so concerned about praying the right words. Just tell God what is on your heart and ask him for guidance. Just do it. Just about all of you play around on Facebook. I've seen the message you share around. We have Bible study every night on that thing. Every night, Monday through Friday. We're doing Romans right now. If you don't like Romans, hey, we've got 24 sessions of Luke that are saved on there. Don't like Luke, we got 72 sessions of John that are saved on there. Don't like any of those? Grab a friend and start your own Bible study. I can't. I don't know how. I don't have time. I'm too busy. Stop it. Lord does not want your excuses. He wants your attention and your devotion. Every day, every day, every day, every day. The bread of life is there for you every day to stay fed and nourished and strengthened and encouraged and ready for whatever comes your way. You have to eat. The alternative? Back to Egypt. Back to slavery, to sin and death. Back to an old life that leads to eternal separation from our Heavenly Father. My prayer is that not a single person in here or a single person watching on Facebook finds that alternative attractive. I pray that all of us, as our communion liturgy tells us, will one day feast at the heavenly table. And we can only get there, friends, if we start taking our daily bread seriously. So who's hungry? In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Now, to be of assistance in the narthex are these little booklets. It's a prayer guide. Now, there was some confusion, I think, at the printers, because it's kind of in an odd order. It's meant to be day 1 through 7. So the very back of it is actually where you would begin. And then as you open it up, you got day 1, you got day 2, and then it skips to day 5, 6, 7. Anyway, you can find the days you're supposed to be doing. Take one of these with you. Because what it is meant to do is to help you for the next 7 days find a way to pray. To get into a habit of some kind of a daily something to be able to partake in the daily bread. There's copies of them back in the narthex. Take 1, 2, pass them out whatever you want to do. If we need more next week, I can bring more. But I just encourage you, be doing something. If you're not already, be doing something every day to strengthen your journey with the Lord. Our prayer this morning will be a responsive prayer. You will hear me say, Lord, in your mercy, and you'll respond by saying, hear our prayer. So again, I'll say, Lord, in your mercy, you'll say what?
Hear our prayer.
Let us pray. God, like the Israelites in the wilderness, we too have known your love and experienced your care and provision. You call us to extend your love to the world around us, to care for others as deeply as we care for ourselves. And so we bring the needs of our world before you now. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those who do not have what they need in order to survive, those without enough food to eat or shelter, those without employment or enough money to pay their bills, those without access to medical care or medicine to keep them healthy. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those who have more than enough to meet their needs, but who continue to feel empty inside, who struggle to find meaning and purpose in life, who turn to alcohol, drugs, or other destructive behaviors to try and hide the pain, those who entertain thoughts of suicide. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those who are struggling physically, those who are battling life-threatening disease or injury, those who are living with chronic pain, those who are coping with Alzheimer's, or those that are facing death. We also bring to you now, Lord, in the quiet of this time with you, those people, places, things, and events on our hearts and minds this morning. Name them before you now, either silently in our hearts or aloud with our lips. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of the first and the last and all those in between, your grace reaches out to all of us, lifelong believers or newcomers alike. You call us to live as citizens of heaven, to work together with one mind and one purpose, to reach out in love to those in need. Strengthen us so that we might live in a manner worthy of the good news we have received, offering our lives to the building up of your sometimes upside-down kingdom, where the last are first and the first are last, and there is grace enough for all. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, we bring these, our petitions, praying them using the words that he taught us, by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Of course, normally we pass it around our offering plate. We're not doing that during this particular season of our church life together. But there is a plate here on the altar. Is also one in the narthex. If you've not already given us your tithe, your gift, or your offering, make sure you do so at the end of the service. If you want to fold it up into an airplane, I won't let you. Throw it into the plate. You can certainly feel free to do that. But in anticipation of those offerings, gifts, and tithes already received, and those that we will receive, I want to offer these prayers at this time. Let us pray. God of grace and compassion, as we offer our tithes and offerings this morning, we remember the lessons in your providing the Israelites with manna in the wilderness. First lesson is you took care of their needs. The second lesson is you gave enough to meet the needs of the day and instructed them to look out for the weak and needy. Finally, Lord, you made clear that accumulating more than they needed would not end well. Help us to learn from these lessons and what you have given to us by your goodness. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. All right, so friends, we are going to attempt a little congregational singing this morning. So, if you feel comfortable doing so, and if not, I understand. If you turn to page 92 in your hymnal, For the Beauty of the Earth, we're going to sing the first verse, the second verse, and the sixth verse. If you feel comfortable, the first verse, the second verse, and the sixth verse. You stay seated while we do this. So page 92, 1, 2, and 6.
Thank you.
the last or first and the first or last, where needs are met in miraculous ways, and there is grace enough for all. And may the blessings of God, the love of Jesus Christ, and the presence of the Holy Spirit surround you and sustain you in the coming days. We go now to love and serve the Lord. Amen.